You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, and welcome to Recreation 100's Dimensions of Leisure. My name is Dr. Mary Lou Kappel, and today I'm discussing nutrition. I will talk about calories and the six forms of nutrients that we need to have each day. Now, these are carbohydrates and fats, protein, vitamins, minerals, and water. I will delve into some of these nutrients a little bit in depth, and also I'm going to be talking about a few of our very favorite fast food restaurants, so you can play along with that part of it. I will actually spend some more time discussing water. Tap water, bottled water, filtered water, and the osmosis process. And I will finish with a warning about the chemical BPA. I know that you will find this session very informative and very practical. So let's get going with the definition first of nutrition. So when you think of nutrition, you need to consider this particular definition. Nutrition is the energy obtained from consuming food and drink. Now, nutrition is related to wellness and fitness, and food is essential as it provides vital nutrients for our survival, and it helps the body function and stay healthy. So it's very important that we know that. Now, there's actually a major that you can, in academia, that you can major in, and it is called nutrition science. You can have this as a career. So it comes in both a bachelor's, master's, and PhD. But anyway, it focuses largely on dietary concerns and health issues surrounding food, eating, and medicine. It's rooted in chemistry, biology, as well as the social sciences. So it looks at the physiological as well as the biochemical processes that are involved in nourishment. It also discusses how substances in food provide energy or are converted into body tissues. It also includes the study of behaviors and social factors related to your food choices. And this gets into the research and the reasons why we select certain foods from emotional as well as psychological aspects. So the question you might ask is, what is good nutrition? Well, this means that you're obtaining the right amount of nutrients from healthy foods in the right combinations and portions. It's choosing the right foods to fuel our bodies and make us feel well and fit. And remember that we all have choices. So having the knowledge about nutrition can help you make informed choices about the foods that you eat. And this can help you also to achieve optimum health over your entire lifetime. This is one of our goals, of course. Now, poor nutrition, on the other hand, can lead to a lack of energy, digestive problems, food allergies, weight gain, depression, and anxiety, as well as many of today's most prevalent chronic diseases like coronary heart disease, diabetes, cancer, and ADHA. So there are, of course, some problems with poor nutrition. And selecting poor, nutritionally dense foods can lead to a lack of energy, weight gain, and digestive problems. Studies have also shown that these poor choices can contribute to depression and anxiety, so I want you to remember that. Now, our first video is an overview of nutrition and healthy eating. It's entitled Balanced Nutrition. You will see many ways to eat healthy and feel really great. Let's take a look at this first video.
Hi, I'm Dana Hunnis, a registered dietitian with UCLA Health. Let's talk about a very important topic that sometimes gets a bad rap, nutrition. Start your day off right with a healthy breakfast. Consider scrambled egg whites or tofu with fruit instead of a bagel or sugar-coated muffin. If you need a snack during the day, consider having Greek yogurt, hummus, or pre-cut veggies and fruit, which will give you a steady energy boost unlike cookies, a chocolate bar, or an energy drink. When you crave something sweet, consider having a piece of fruit instead. It's nature's candy. Whenever possible, eat fresh foods. And for increased benefits, buy locally grown and organic. They're fresher, tastier, and right off the farm, making them even more nutritious. Also, buying fruits and vegetables while in season costs less. Visit local farms, which offer the option to pick your own fruit and or veggies, and make it a fun event for the whole family. Consider joining a community-supported agriculture program, where you can receive a box of in-season produce from your local farm delivered right to your home. If you don't have easy access to fresh food or to keep these foods longer, consider frozen instead of canned. Choose lean meats that have less saturated fat. Vary your protein consumption by eating seafood 2 times a week. According to the United States Department of Agriculture, eating 8 ounces of seafood per week may help reduce the risk of heart disease. Reduce or eliminate your soda intake. Choose water instead. Remember, we eat with our eyes first. Bring some color to your plate to make your meals more interesting. Enjoy dark green vegetables such as broccoli, romaine lettuce, and spinach, as well as bright red and orange foods such as red peppers, pumpkin, sweet potatoes, and juicy tomatoes. Whether staying in or eating out, choose grilled or baked foods, which are lower in saturated fat and calories than fried or breaded foods. Enjoy your food, but reduce portions. Many times, just serving your meal on a smaller plate will help you reduce your portion size. Just making a few conscious choices about what and how you eat is all you need to get started. I'm Dana. Thanks for watching.
So let's talk about calories. I'm sure you've all heard that word before. Well, that has a definition. And remember that calories measure the energy that's in the food that you consume. The number of calories in a food is a measure of how much potential energy that a food possesses. So you want to make sure that you know that 1 gram of carbohydrates has 4 calories, and 1 gram of protein has 4 calories. And then we have the fat. 1 gram of fat is loaded with calories. It has 9. So let's take a look at this next video, which describes what is a calorie. And we'll learn more about this.
We hear about calories all the time. How many calories are in this cookie? How many are burned by 100 jumping jacks, or long distance running, or fidgeting? But what is a calorie really? And how many of them do we actually need? Calories are a way of keeping track of the body's energy budget. A healthy balance occurs when we put in about as much energy as we lose. If we consistently put more energy into our bodies than we burn, the excess will gradually be stored as fat in our cells and will gain weight. If we burn off more energy than we replenish, we'll lose weight. So we have to be able to measure the energy we consume and use, and we do so with a unit called the calorie. 1 calorie, the kind we measure in food, also called a large calorie, is defined as the amount of energy it would take to raise the temperature of 1 kilogram of water by 1 degree Celsius. Everything we consume has a calorie count, a measure of how much energy the item stores in its chemical bonds. The average pizza slice has 272 calories. There are about 78 in a piece of bread, and an apple has about 52. That energy is released during digestion and stored in other molecules that can be broken down to provide energy when the body needs it. It's used in 3 ways. About 10% enables digestion, about 20% fuels physical activity, and the biggest chunk, around 70%, supports the basic functions of our organs and tissues. That third usage corresponds to your basal metabolic rate, a number of calories you would need to survive if you weren't eating or moving around. Add in some physical activity and digestion, and you arrive at the official guidelines for how many calories the average person requires each day, 2,000 for women and 2,500 for men. Those estimates are based on factors like average weight, physical activity, and muscle mass. So does that mean everyone should shoot for around 2,000 calories? Not necessarily. If you're doing an energy-guzzling activity, like cycling the Tour de France, your body could use up to 9,000 calories per day. Pregnancy requires slightly more calories than usual. And elderly people typically have a slower metabolic rate. Energy is burned more gradually, so less is needed. Here's something else you should know before you start counting calories. The calorie counts on nutrition labels measure how much energy the food contains, not how much energy you can actually get out of it. Fibrous foods like celery and whole wheat take more energy to digest, so you'd actually wind up with less energy from a 100-calorie serving of celery than a 100-calorie serving of potato chips. Not to mention the fact that some foods offer nutrients like protein and vitamins, while others provide far less nutritional value. Eating too many of those foods could leave you overweight and malnourished. And even with the exact same food, different people might not get the same number of calories. Variations in things like enzyme levels, gut bacteria, and even intestine length means that every individual's ability to extract energy from food is a little different. So a calorie is a useful energy measure, but to work out exactly how many of them each of us requires, we need to factor in things like exercise, food type, and our body's ability to process energy. Good luck finding all of that on a nutrition label.
So there are some variables to note when we're expending our calories. And one of them, of course, is your age, your gender, your height, your current weight, your activity level, your metabolism rate, and what you're doing every single day, whether that's being very active or you're being very sedentary or what you're doing. You're lifting weights, you're running, or perhaps you're just doing nothing and you're watching TV. So let's take a look at this next video and let's review the concepts of calories and how many we need each day, which is very important. And this video is entitled Calorie Nutrition.
Calories. What are calories? Calories are a measurement of energy from food for your body. For instance, a 4-ounce chicken breast would provide about 124 calories, and an 8-ounce baked sweet potato would provide 159 calories. The macronutrients, fats, carbohydrates, and proteins, are what provide the energy from foods. Fat provides the most calories or energy, providing 9 calories per gram. Carbohydrates and proteins provide 4 calories per gram, and it's best to get your calories from a mixture of the macronutrients. So, how many calories does a person need? Well, this is not a simple answer. We've all heard about finding caloric balance. Calories in equals calories out. Calories in, well, that's pretty simple. That's how much you eat. Calories out has basically two things: your metabolism, or your body using energy to maintain itself, and how much physical movement you do. If you consistently put more calories into your body than you use, you will gain weight. And if you consistently use more calories than you put in, you will lose weight. It's estimated that the average male needs about 2,400 calories a day, and the average female needs about 2,000 calories per day. These estimates are based on age and how active a person is, with activity level being a huge factor. And that is the basics on calories.
So you might wonder, well, how many calories can I have every single day? Well, there's a range for different age groups. And of course, if you're a child, then it would be a lot more calories depending on your age. But just for like women and teen girls, men and women, if you're a female, then you have about 1,200 to 2,000 calories. Teen girls have about 2,200. You can see that's a little bit more. Men, they can eat 2,000 to 3,000. And then teen boys, about 3,000. So that's based on your age as well as your gender. So when you're burning up calories, with all things being equal, if a person eats more calories than he or she burns each day, there's a weight gain. On the other hand, if more calories are burned than are consumed on a daily basis, there's a weight loss. So you probably wonder, well, what about those extra calories? Where do they go? Well, When you're consumed, when you have consumed these extra calories, the enzymes that synthesize fat are stimulated, and then fat is stored throughout the body. In males, it's usually deposited in the abdomen section, and the women, it's in our hips and thighs. So another topic I want to get into is fast food. There's a definition for it, and it's food that can be prepared quickly and easily. It's sold in restaurants, snack bars, as a quick meal to be taken out or delivered. There actually is a term for that type of restaurant. It's called quick service restaurant. It's the QSR. And what that means is that fast food cuisine has minimal table service, which means you don't have a waiter coming over to you, as you would have in fine dining. Now, more than a third of American adults eat at fast food restaurants every day. And you might wonder, well, why do we do that? Well, we choose fast food for a lot of different reasons. I think probably the first reason to consider is that it's convenient. Also, we have lots of choices and locations. There are drive-thrus where you just order and drive on through, pick up your food, and keep on going. So that's quick. They do have fast service, even if it's not a drive-thru. And it's relatively inexpensive. They always have some kind of deals going on. Also, you have so much variety within those fast food restaurants. And you know what? It tastes good. So those are just some of the reasons why we would select some of the fast food. Now, there are some problems, unfortunately, with consuming too much fast food. So the meat products in the animals that you're eating are pumped with antibiotics to keep them from getting sick. And deep fried foods are high in fat and low in nutritional value. Chicken and other foods are breaded and fried. This is generally speaking. Usually they use cheap ingredients. This is not the case everywhere. These are generalities. And unfortunately, there may be unclean kitchen utensils as well as workers. So those are some reasons that you see. And there are also other things. One of them is food additives. So this is any substance used in the production, processing, treatment, packaging, transportation, or storage of a food. Now, xanthan gum is used a lot. If you read the labels on your products, you'll see this in salad dressings, chocolate milk, bakery fillings, and other foods to add texture to the food product. They also might add into your food product certified colors. And they use preservatives and salt. So now I'm going to take you through just a few fast food restaurants and just take a look at some of their products so that you can be aware of their nutritional value. The first one I'm going to look at is McDonald's, the Golden Arches. It's been around for a number of years. I remember in high school going to McDonald's all the time. So I wanted you to be aware that a McDonald's Big Mac has 540 calories, 29 grams of fat, and 25 grams of protein. If you were to order the McDonald's large fries, you would have 500 calories, 25 grams of fat, 6 grams of protein, and then if you have just one ketchup packet, that's 15 calories. And then they consider the rest of that stuff to be okay. If you are super hungry in the morning and you ordered an Egg McMuffin, you'll note that it has 300 calories, 12 grams of fat, and 18 grams of protein. Now, if you decided you're going to go healthy and you wanted to get a Southwest salad with grilled chicken, you're a little better off. And you have 320 calories, 9 grams of fat, and 30 grams of protein. That's if you have no salad dressing. However, most of us add salad dressing to our salads. If you were to add on the creamy Caesar salad dressing, it'd be 190 calories, 18 grams of fat, and 2 grams of protein. If you were to choose a different form of salad dressing, like the balsamic, it'd be only 40 calories, 3 grams of fat, and 0 grams of protein. So you can make a choice on those, of course, as long as you know what you're eating. And if you succumb to the chocolate milkshake, you will get 560 calories, 16 grams of fat and 12 grams of protein. So you can see if you have a typical McDonald's fare, if you had the French fries, the Big Mac, and you had the milkshake, you would have, you got your calculator, but you would have a lot of grams of fat, I would guess over 50, and you'd have a lot of calories. So if you're a small person, you'd obviously be very, very full, and if you're a big guy, maybe not so much. Okay, let's go to In-N-Out Burger. This is a very popular restaurant. So if you were to order at In-N-Out a hamburger, that would be 390 calories. It would be 19 grams of fat and 16 grams of protein. And if you were to put some cheese on that, the cheeseburger would be 480 calories. Notice how the calories went up. It's 27 grams of fat and 22 grams of protein. So by adding the cheese, you get a lot more fat. If you were to order French fries, those are 370 calories, 15 grams of fat, 6 grams of protein. Now, if you were to order the Coke Classic, this is about 16 ounces and it's 200 calories, no fat, no protein, and 54 grams of sugar. Now, if you take a look at the diagram here on In-N-Out French fries, and if you go to the nutritional value for In-N-Out, you'll be able to see these for most of their products. It's really rather informative, where it tells you about the protein, carbohydrates, and fat. So it gives you a visual about what you are actually eating. And the pink you can see is the fat. And let's see, the carbohydrates are the yellow. So you can take a look at that and see what your nutritional value is. Okay, let's go to Taco Bell. So if you were to order a Taco Bell Burrito Supreme, the beef one, not the chicken one, it'd be 390 calories, 16 grams of fat, 14 grams of protein. Let's go to Subway. If you love Subway like I do, you might want to order the 6 ounce or maybe even the full 12 inch, but this one is just for the 6 ounce, oven roasted chicken breast, which is 270 calories, 3.5 grams of fat, and 23 grams of protein. Good choice, a lot of protein and not that much fat. However, when you start going, staying at Subway and you decided to get the 6-inch meatball marinara, I love this one, you have more calories, you have 430 calories, it's almost twice as much, 18 grams of fat, that definitely is more than the chicken, and 20 grams of protein. And if you wanted to top off your dinner with a cookie, in particular, this one is the raspberry one, it would be 230 calories, 11 grams of fat, and 2 grams of protein. So I just selected a few different fast food restaurants, and of course I want you to make your own choices about what you want to eat and what your needs are. So in this next video entitled Fast Food Effects on the Body, it features Dr. Travis Stork. He has a TV show, and it's called The Doctors, and he describes his personal experiment of eating fast food for 5 days and how he was affected. Let's see what happened in his 5-day eating spree. Let's take a look.
But I'm going to show you guys in this magic wall animation what can happen to you. You all may remember last year, I actually went on a Project Unhealthy. In 5 days, I gained 8 pounds. In 5 days, I actually became hypertensive, developed high blood pressure. I don't even want to know what was going on inside my body. America, listen up. This is what you're doing to yourself. I did it for 5 days. I felt miserable. I gained weight. I put my body in jeopardy, and it wasn't worth it. And you know what? I'm never going to do it again. Why did I do it? To prove a point. When you eat these foods, it causes an addictive pattern in your mind. But in the end, all you end up is overweight, lethargic, and not feeling good about yourself. This is me. So what happened when I ate a fast food meal? Well, something very simple. The contents enter your stomach, and I'm gonna circle some of these contents that I call some of the killer contents of food. Sodium. These are fat molecules. These are refined sugar molecules. No big deal, right? Well, it is a big deal because when they hit your stomach, good things start happening, believe it or not. That's that dopamine release in your brain because dopamine and serotonin are going wild. You feel great. Oh my gosh, this tastes wonderful. It does, right? For the first few minutes. But things are also going on inside your body that aren't so great. Your pancreas is secreting more and more insulin to deal with that massive sugar overload from the fries, from the white bun, from the soda. Insulin does one thing, it drives sugar into cells, but it does something else. It tells your body to store fat. Why else would you have eaten a meal that big and that many calories unless you're about to go into hibernation? That's what you do when you hibernate. You grow a big belly. That fat that you see here, those fat cells actually grow in size. They start to secrete even more toxic substances, leading to heart disease, diabetes, and so many other things. All that sodium causes your blood pressure to go up, so your heart's beating twice as fast against twice as much resistance. And in your brain, you no longer are releasing dopamine, but instead, your brain is signaling you to release cortisol. Cortisol is a chronic stress hormone that ironically tells you to store even more fat. And last, but certainly not least, what isn't going on in my brain right now? I'm 30 minutes after my meal. There's no more dopamine. There's no more serotonin. I'm lethargic. I feel unhappy. I don't feel good about myself. And that is why when you first eat a fast food meal, you feel great. And 30 minutes later, you feel terrible.
Oh, yeah.
Kim.
Yes.
After everything you have heard here today, would you be willing to try to make some changes?
Yes.
I'm going to give you a copy of this book, The Lean Belly Prescription. The reason I'm going to do it is because this has foods in it that taste great, that are also good for you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Kim, for being such a great sport.
So I thought, hopefully you thought that was kind of an interesting video, just to see how his body changed only after 5 days. So once again, I wanted to remind you that there are nutritional values in the fast food restaurant era on their websites. So most of them have a description of all of their products. Actually, it's really quite easy to find and to read. And it gives consumers information about the calories, the fat, the total amount of carbohydrates, salt, all this different information that is in their food products. So please go to their websites beforehand and take a look at the products that you have so you can become a more informed consumer. Now, I wanted to suggest that you take a look at a book. It's called Eat This, Not That. It comes out usually every year, so it's an annual production, and it describes the best and the worst foods in America. It's really nifty to look at. And when you think about eating this or that, you probably are looking at what you love to eat, and then maybe you don't want to eat that anymore based on the information that's given, and it does give you an alternative. So when you think of junk food or healthy food, we want to take a look at this next video because it does show what 200 calories looks like. It's kind of interesting, and it's quite an eye-opener too because it does give you some comparisons, and remember, these products have 200 calories each. Let's take a look.
We are always obsessing over how many calories we are taking in every day. But do you really understand how many calories are really in the food that we eat? Let's break down some of our favorite foods with their real caloric intake. 200 calories, junk versus healthy food. Fast food. First up is junk food. For a pizza slice with pepperoni, you'll just eat half. You want a Big Mac? Then you'll be eating a little bit less with 1/3 portion to fit that meaty burger into your diet, since it has almost 600 calories. But if you want a plain hot dog without the condiments nor the toasty bun, you can eat a whole hot dog and a quarter bite just to make it to the 200 count. Fruits and veggies. Just wait and see how much healthy food you can eat for 200 calories. Cut out 2 apples for a good snack, or trade it for 2 medium bananas, 4 peaches, 40 cherries, or 100 grapes. You can have around 10 medium tomatoes, 50 baby carrots, but watch out as the calorie count will rise quickly with the fatty dip. Since celery has very few calories, you can honestly eat it all day since one strip has 1 calorie. But not all veggies are light since one large white potato has almost 300 calories. Fried food. Even if it's not shocking to know that greasy food isn't good for you, you can only eat 4 small slices of bacon to stay under the 200 calorie mark. A leg of fried chicken barely reaches that amount too. 2 small kid-sized fries is all you can eat, not including the rest of the fast food. It's okay to add fried onions on top of your hot dog, but avoid using more than 100 grams or you'll be way over the 200 calories. Meats. A lean cut of steak is what you'll have to eat since it only contains 160 calories. 3 eggs are included in that as well, or you can trade it for 100 grams of Atlantic salmon or duck, 170 grams of turkey, 5 chicken wings, 29 shrimp, 2 pork cutlets, 2 chicken drumsticks, or 3/4 of an entire chicken breast. Pastries. Sorry, sweets fans. Keeping those 200 calories in a blueberry muffin means you can only eat half of it. An average piece of chocolate cake will have to be sliced in half. A very small croissant with nothing else on top of it will fit your 200 calorie fix. You will have to cut out 1/5 of your favorite glazed donut to enjoy it for breakfast. And what about that toasted plain bagel? You're going to have to leave a quarter behind so you only eat 200 calories. And that's not including the cream cheese. Nuts. You have been warned because you can only have less than 1.5 ounces of peanuts for a snack. About 28 almonds make up 200 calories, since each one contains 7 calories. Are you a fan of roasted pecans? Stick with an ounce or 28 grams to keep up with the 200 calories. If you like eating peanut butter straight out of the jar, you're out of luck because you can only have 2 tablespoons. Processed food. 2.5 chocolate chip cookies is all you can eat for a light dessert. If you're feeling some Fruit Loops cereal without the milk, you can eat up to 51 grams in one sitting. Are you craving some gummy bears? You can only eat 18 of them. Feeling popcorn tonight? You'll have a quick bite after eating 2 ounces, or 57 grams if you don't include any extra butter on top. If you're in the mood for some Oscar Mayer bologna, 2 3/4 slices will be perfect for a classic sandwich. Dairy. While milk has lots of nutrients, drink 1.5 cups of whole milk to drink about 200 calories. But if you choose 1% milk, you can have 2 full cups. Don't eat a whole container or 8 ounces of yogurt if you don't want to go over 200 calories. But feel free to eat 2 containers of around the same size for Greek yogurt. And if you're feeling cheese for a quick snack, you're stuck with a small little cube, so enjoy it while it lasts. Fatty liquids. Adding 1 cream and sugar to your coffee allows you to have 2 normal-sized coffees a day. Do you want to turn your coffee to a specialty drink? Well, it turns out you'll drink 1/3 of it to keep your 200-calorie diet. You can only have a 1/2 liter of Coca-Cola if you want any soda. 2 glasses of wine fall under 200 calories, while a bottle and a quarter of beer is all you can drink. Liquids. A plain cup of brewed coffee only has 2 calories. Is it really true? Can you imagine how much water and coffee it would take to reach 200 calories? Tea also has 2 calories. And depending on how you make your smoothie, you can have 2 lean smoothies that equal about 90 calories each.
So there are some healthier alternatives. And what you can find, hopefully, are products that have no fillers in meat, natural food items that may be organic, fresh ingredients that are daily brought into the restaurant, those ingredients with no preservatives, no fried foods, and of course, skip the extra bread and butter if it's served to you. So those are some different ideas that you can have. Now let's take a look at Chipotle, the Mexican grill. They have all kinds of foods there. They have the burritos, the tacos, salads, meats, veggies, rice, and beans. So those are some good choices. Actually, it's quite a healthy restaurant, and I think you might enjoy going to Chipotle. It has a lot of selection, and they do have fresh ingredients. So let's take a look at Chick-fil-A. Chick-fil-A has in their products no trans fats. That's a big deal these days. It has grilled chicken nuggets, has chicken salads, grilled market salad, and a multi-grain breakfast oatmeal. So those are some choices that you can get there, but they also have French fries. They also have fried sandwiches also. So you have to kind of look to what their menu is and remember that the toppings that you put on there, whether it's the mayo or the salad dressing or whatever, will add some more calories to it. So let's take a look at another restaurant. It's called the Greenleaf Gourmet Chop Shop. I love this place. It is a farm-to-face concept, and they provide healthy and delicious meals that are sourced from fresh local ingredients. You basically go through the line and you build your own salad. You even choose your own types of greens, and then you select four toppings. I really like this place. So some other fast food strategies for you to take a look at when you go to any of these restaurants. First of all, drink water, not sugary sodas, shakes, or specialty drinks. Choose low-fat dressings for salads. They all have those, so you can do that. Swap fried for grilled foods. Order a child's meal if they allow that. Read nutritional information before ordering it, and sometimes it could just shock you. My shock was looking at the Cheesecake Factory's nutritional values and seeing how many calories and fat were in a slice of cheesecake. That was an eye-opener. You can also, before ordering, scan the menu. Oftentimes they have highlighted somewhere lean types of foods, organic foods, and specialty foods. And don't order any extra toppings like croutons or cheese or fried anything. Add more vegetables to your food order. And don't wait until you're just starving because you will eat everything in sight. You need to stay disciplined and be very selective. So in looking at these nutrients again, the components in foods that are utilized so that we can survive and grow are called those nutrients. Now they also build and repair tissues. They regulate body processes and are converted and used for energy. So that will include the top 5 nutrients, not the water. So these are the 6 nutrients that I'm going to discuss: the carbs, fats, protein, vitamins, minerals, and water. So the first, let's do the carbohydrates, also called carbs. These are the sugars and starches and fibers that are found in fruits, grains, vegetables, and milk products. They provide continuous energy or fuel for your body, especially the brain and the nervous system. This is why they're so important to have. They're also slowly digested, and they're a primary source of energy when you're exercising. So there's 2 types of carbs, simple and complex. And every day, your daily diet should be 40 to 60% complex. Now, the next video gives us an overview of carbohydrates and discusses the differences between simple and complex. Examples are given. Let's take a look at this one, and it's called, "What are carbohydrates?"
Most people who want to get into better shape believe carbs are unhealthy. It is sad to see how many people believe that a carb-cutting diet is a path to rapid weight loss. Carbs are what the body needs for energy. Without carbs, you won't be able to burn fat, and you'll be depriving your body of the minerals and vitamins it requires to function properly. A balanced diet is all it takes to lose weight easily, quickly, and correctly. This video will discuss what are carbohydrates and what types are best for your overall well-being. What are carbs? Carbs are the fiber, sugars, and starches contained in the food you eat. Much like fat and protein, carbohydrates are a macronutrient. Macronutrients are what give the body energy, with carbs being the primary source. We must eat protein, fat, and carbs since our body can't produce macronutrients on its own. There are 2 types of carbohydrates: complex carbs and simple carbs. Complex carbohydrates take a lengthy duration to process in the body. They help with the prolonged release of energy due to high amounts of nutrients and vitamins. Complex carbohydrates are beneficial when you're trying to maintain a healthy lifestyle, as they provide the body with extra nutrition to use and last longer as a source of energy. Several examples of complex carbohydrates are brown rice, whole grains, wheat, oats, starchy vegetables, beans, peas, and lentils. Any kind of food containing these ingredients is much better for your body than their processed equivalent. Simple carbohydrates are akin to processed food. They are regarded as simple sugars. Simple carbs get separated in the body very fast and are used as an immediate energy source that burns out faster. They can be detrimental to the body when regularly consumed, since they are comprised of refined sugars with minimal vitamins or nutrients. Some examples of simple carbohydrates include honey, sugar, fruit juices, milk, candy, soda, and biscuits. Now that you know the difference between complex and simple carbs, let's address the truly bad carbohydrates, refined carbs. If you are attempting to lose weight, you must reduce your consumption of refined carbohydrates. Refined carbs are the main cause of obesity and consist of high levels of fats, calories, and sugars. Processed or refined carbohydrates are germ and bran-less grains, and as such, have decreased nutrient content. Refined carbs are found in foods made with white flour, cereals, pizza, pasta, bread, etc., as well as white rice. Sugary beverages and potato chips are also high in refined carbs. Refined sugar is regarded as a refined carbohydrate. Therefore, ice creams, cookies, cakes, and donuts are the most typical refined carb sources. Integrate fresh vegetables, whole grains, fruits, and foods with fiber in your meals. They contain the proper carbs you should be feeding your body. Always choose the good source of carbs. The good carbs can help you instead of the ones that will hurt you.
So let's take a look now at simple carbohydrates, or the sugars. Now, sugar is found naturally in fruits and vegetables or in refined table sugar, syrup, soda, cake, and candy. The natural sources of sugar are healthy and they're filled with vitamins and minerals. However, refined sugar usually has no nutritional value. And most of the refined simple sugars have been depleted of natural fiber, vitamins, and minerals, and are usually a poor source of calories. These are called empty calories, calories with little or no nutritional value. Now, I'm not saying that they're not tasty, because they certainly are. Love donuts. Anyway, there are a lot of names for sugar, and you do have to read the package. You have to look at the label to see how they have disguised sugar. Now, obviously, brown sugar and cane sugar say sugar, but some of the other ones don't. It's like fructose, glucose, corn syrup, if you don't know that's a sugar, honey, of course, we know what that is, malt syrup, maltose, molasses, sorbitol, those are, and sucrose, those are some of those names that they sort of throw in there to, I think, confuse us even more, putting down, but they really want to know the source of the sugar, which is why they do that. So you really want to know where the sugar came from. You can buy a 5-pound bag of sugar, or you can have it in soft drinks. Now, there's a problem with having too much sugar, because excessive sugar, the simple carbohydrates, can lead to nutritional deficiency, because remember, they don't have many vitamins or minerals in them. Obesity, diabetes, tooth decay, coronary heart disease, fatigue, and depression. So those are some things that you want to avoid, and those soft drinks are part of that long list. In the next video, it will give you some results of eating sugar. And it's in what sugar does to your body, and none of it is good.
Sugar is a big no-no when it comes to our health and fitness. And it's no coincidence, as sugar really does bad things to our systems. In case you are not totally aware of these, here's what happens to your system specifically when you take too much sugar. Number one, sugar ages your face. Studies have shown that those with higher sugar in their blood tend to look older than those with lower levels. In fact, for every millimeter per liter raise in blood sugar levels, the perceived age of that individual rose by at least 5 months. Number two, sugar is linked to acne. Although not many studies have found a clear link between sugar and acne, there is some evidence that sugar contributes to acne outbreaks in the face and body. If you suspect this is the culprit of your acne symptoms, do a little experiment and avoid sugar and refined carbs and see if you notice things getting better. Number three, sugar, and especially sugary drinks, raise the risk of developing diabetes type 2 by 83%. In a relevant study with over 90,000 women subjects, the women who drink a high sugary drink every day had an 83% raised risk of developing diabetes 2 compared to those who consume sugary drinks less often. Number four, sugar gives empty calories. Although sugar may act as a very temporary source of energy, it is completely void of any nutrients and minerals that are good for you. Number five, sugar makes us feel hungry. A relevant study by Yale University has found that the people who consume more sugar compared to others tend to feel more hungry afterwards, and sugar only provides empty calories. Number 6. Sugar blocks leptin and increases insulin to huge levels. Leptin is actually a hormone responsible for sending our systems a signal that we are full and shouldn't be eating more. However, when we take sugar, this hormone is blocked, and we tend to feel more prone to eat more. Not only that, it also raises insulin levels in our brains, and this makes any attempts to burn fat and lose weight extra hard. Number 7. It leads to belly fat. If you have a tendency to store fat in your belly region, perhaps sugar could be a possible factor why. There are actually many studies who have found a link between sugar consumption and belly fat, as well as heart diseases. Now, some people may be wondering about fruit, which is rich in natural sugars. Since fruit contains sugars that come with nutrients, you can consume fruit in moderation without any worries. However, they still contain sugar, and you should opt for wholesome fruits instead of juices and smoothies, as these end up having a higher sugar content due to their juicing process. Found our video useful? Don't forget to click on the like button and subscribe to our channel for more awesome health and fitness tips.
So hopefully you can see that sugar definitely is an addictive source of perhaps energy, but no vitamins and minerals, unless they have to throw them back in there. So if you have a sweet tooth or crave sugar, there is a possible explanation. Not that you're just not disciplined, but researchers have found that sugar may have addictive qualities. When we eat sugar, opioids and dopamine are released in the brain. And this gives you a pleasurable high, and so you eat more and you repeat the behavior. So excess sugar impairs both our cognitive skills and our self-control. For many people, having a little sugar sort of stimulates the craving for more or stimulates your brain and you're okay, but having too much of it is not good for you. It does have drug-like effects, and the effects can also be part of the reward center in your brain. So overeating alters our brain's reward system, which then further drives overeating. Now, there are some other problems associated with sugar. It causes inflammation in the brain, leading to memory difficulties. And sugar also affects your mood. And this is not with everybody. These are merely generalizations and points that I want to give to you. And then people with type 2 diabetes reported increased feelings of sadness and anxiety during acute hypoglycemia, which is their elevated blood sugar. So in the next video, I think it's really important for us to watch this. We're going to see why sugar is bad for you. Let's take a look.
You know sugar isn't good for you, but why? Why is this seemingly innocent, powdery white substance so demonized? Sugar is a chemical substance that our bodies need, but in its natural form, it comes with a buffer of fiber, pectin, and other more easily metabolized substances. In natural fruits, sugar is easily digested by the body because it is in a low enough quantity added by buffers so that your body can break it down slowly. Enter the processed high fructose, sucralose, cane sugar. These sugars cannot be broken down by the body. New studies show that the highly processed sugars we are consuming are as addictive as cocaine. We're also eating about 160 pounds of it annually. And we aren't exactly cavemen and women who need it as we did in the Paleolithic times to help us store fat for the winter. It's now cheaper to eat a candy bar full of processed sugar than it is to eat an apple. We eat the candy bar, the cookies, and the cakes, but we also eat sugar in foods we didn't even know had processed sugars in them, like applesauce or granola, spaghetti sauce, or even foods sold as diet foods. So why is sugar bad for you? Because it is like cocaine, and food manufacturers know that. They want you addicted to their sugary foods, not eating an apple. That's because the more you eat these foods, just as with any addiction, the more you want them. Your brain rewards the behavior and then ups the ante. Eating one candy bar doesn't make you feel as good as eating two, then three, and so on. The next time you crave sugar, ask yourself, have you been the guinea pig for a chemical experiment? That's right, put down the sugar. Your health depends on it.
You might have heard the term spiking. Now, this is not the football. This is in terms of nutrition. What spiking is a rapid rise in your blood sugar level. And this is seen when you have ingested way too many carbohydrates of simple sugar. Now, the sugar does provide the body with nearly instant amounts of energy, but the sugar level drops soon after ingesting the simple sugars. I've heard that it's anywhere from 20 to 30 minutes. But what that does is creates a quick drop in energy and a craving for more. So you feel bad, and then you want to eat more chocolate or other types of snacks. Now, let's look at something that's much better. And these are the complex carbohydrates, or the starches. Now, these are found in starches in whole grains, such as steel-cut oats, fruits, vegetables, and legumes. And legumes are dried peas and beans. Now, these carbohydrates are slowly released into the energy into our body over a longer period of time than do those simple carbohydrates. And these are obviously better for your body. So you have a lot of choices here when you talk about complex carbohydrates. We can take a look at brown rice, buckwheat, bulgur, millet, wild rice, quinoa, which is my favorite, steel-cut oats, tetrakal, whole rye, or whole wheat. Now remember that your vegetables are complex carbohydrates, so that's very important for you to remember. And then fruits are also complex carbohydrates. Many fruits are, and bananas as well as apples are great choices. Now the next video discusses that not all carbs are created equal. They're all also cooked. They're also cooked up a healthy carb meal that is vegan in this particular video. Now this video is entitled Understanding Carbs.
When we think about eating healthy, some people think of carbs as a dirty word and won't eat them at all. But it's a little bit more involved than that. So today, I am with Stephanie from Food Wonderful. Stephanie, let's first talk about what exactly is a carb.
So a carbohydrate food is any food that is digested and becomes sugar. Carbohydrates are one of three macronutrients, so along with protein and fat, carbohydrates provide the calories in our diet. Simple carbohydrates are foods that have shorter chain sugars, so they're digested very quickly. They get into our bloodstream right away. Complex carbohydrates have a longer chain sugar, so they take a little bit longer to digest, and they usually give us more steady energy throughout the day.
So Stephanie, a lot of foods have carbs, but they're not all the same.
That's right. So our complex carbohydrates like beans, whole grains, those foods are very nutritious. They provide us fiber, B vitamins, so we want to eat those foods. And even our simple carbohydrates like fruit have a lot of good nutrition, so those are worthwhile to eat as well. The foods that we want to limit or eat more in moderation are those very sugary foods, cookies, soda.
So really, it's not about cutting carbohydrates out of your diet. It's about choosing the right ones.
That's exactly right. Carbohydrates are an essential part of our diet. So when we start to replace some of our less nutritious carbohydrate foods with some of these great complex carbs, we find that we'll have more energy, we'll have more nutrients, and we'll feel better through the day.
So today you've got a great example of a recipe that we're gonna cook that is good carbohydrates.
That's exactly right. We're making a vegan recipe, which is a chickpea sweet potato curry.
Yummy.
All right, here's our ingredients for our curry. We have lots of great sources of complex carbs. We have our sweet potatoes, our chickpeas, and our green peas. These foods will provide carbohydrates and protein too.
I love it. Let's make it.
First, we're gonna add our onions. And we're gonna let these saute for about 10 minutes. Add in our jalapeno chili, garlic. We have some curry powder, some garam masala, some paprika. Pour in our coconut milk, our tomatoes, Basically, as soon as those spices are fragrant, the curry is ready to go.
I can't wait to try it, but I think the biggest takeaway is to not cut carbs out of your diet completely, but choose the best carbs for your body.
That's exactly right. Food like this is gonna keep us full and satisfied and give us great energy for the entire day.
I love that. Thank you so much. I can't wait to dig in. For Stephanie's recipe or more healthy eating information, just head to our website, livinghealthytv.com.
So now I wanna talk about fiber. Now, fiber is a plant-based nutrient that's sometimes called roughage or bulk. Fiber moves bulk through the digestive tract and controls your pH, which is your acidity levels, in the intestines. Now, fiber also promotes regular bowel movements and prevents constipation. Now, adults need about 20 to 30 grams of fiber every day for good health, but most Americans get only about 15 a day. Present in all plant foods would be fiber, and these would include your fruits, vegetables, grains, and legumes. And remember that fiber necessarily doesn't have to be an energy source. So let's take a look at what's called soluble fiber. This is why I'm going to talk about the energy source. Now, this dissolves in water to form a gel-like substance that slows down digestion. That's the purpose of it, because then it could help stabilize blood sugar levels and curb your hunger. So some examples of soluble fiber would be whole grains like oats and barley, legumes, grains like oatmeal, flaxseed, and chia seeds. Also peas, beans, and brown rice. In the fruit section, it would be apples, citrus fruits, and carrots. So those were some examples of soluble fiber. Let's go on to what is insoluble fiber. Now, this does not dissolve in water and remains intact or less changed as that food moves through your gastrointestinal tract. It adds bulk to the stool and helps food pass more quickly through the stomach and intestines. Now, your body doesn't break down the insoluble fiber, so it just goes through your digestive system and it helps move everything else along. It does increase your stool, and examples of insoluble fiber, again, would be, these are good things for you to have, would be wheat bran, seeds, nuts, and dark leafy vegetables. So those are really, really great examples of foods with fiber. Now let's take a look at not foods, but supplements. Now, fiber supplements are good for you. They may be needed, and they are available in many different forms as well as brands. Taking them allows the amount of fiber to increase in your diet, especially if you're not eating enough vegetables and fruits or other types of fibrous foods. And they're good if you're not eating enough from those foods, and maybe you're kind of skimping and eating a few too many chips or something like that. So one of the choices to get would be Fiberwell's sugar-free gummies. These are like chewies, and they're 5 grams of fiber per serving. And they're also what they consider to be a prebiotic fiber, which apparently is good for you. These are sugar-free. They taste great. There's 3 different flavors, and they are gluten-free. Another type of fiber that you can have is called Benefiber, and this is a powder of wheat dextrin. It's sugar-free. It's grit-free. A lot of people complain about the grit. It's gluten-free. You dissolve it in water or juice, and the dosage is 2 teaspoons daily into a beverage of some sort, and that is only 15 calories. So my gastrointestinal physician, who I see frequently, has always suggested that product is very good. Now, okay, we've talked about carbohydrates, let's put that aside, and now let's talk about fats. So the reason we need to have fats in our diet is to control our blood pressure and to help with blood clotting. So fats also help us with stored energy, and they insulate our body. They protect the vital organs such as the kidneys and the heart and the liver, and they taste good. And because they are heavy, they make you feel full after eating. So they recommend 20 to 30% of your daily diet of fats. But all fats are not the same. The bad fats are called saturated and trans fats, and these are the ones that increase the risk for certain diseases. There are some good fats, and they're called monounsaturated and polyunsaturated fats, and they're the ones that lower your disease risk. And the key to a healthy diet is to substitute the bad fats for the good fats, because they will helpfully avoid any type of cardiovascular problems. So we're wondering, well, where are the saturated fats? Well, you find them in all animal products: beef, beef fat, veal, lean, pork, lard, because a lot of people still cook with lard. It's also in butter and cream, ice cream, unfortunately, and cheeses. Now, you find it also in vegetable products, which might be coconut oil, palm oil, kernel oil, and tropical oils such as cocoa butter. So you want to really go low on saturated fats. Okay, so we have the Cheesecake Factory. I want to go back to that. I wanted to tell you that the Cheesecake Factory is a wonderful place to eat. However, there are, when you order one piece of cheesecake, there are 400 calories in that and 28 grams of fat. So now let's take a look at a video that discusses the different types of fats in risk factors for the heart diseases.
There are three types of fats: saturated, unsaturated, and trans fats. Saturated fat is naturally solid at room temperature. Examples of saturated fats include butter, cheese, and the marbling in beef. Saturated fat comes primarily from animal sources, and diets high in saturated fat increase LDL, the bad cholesterol. Unsaturated fats are naturally liquid at room temperature. Examples of unsaturated fats include olive oil, canola oil, the oil in nuts and seeds, and the oils in fish and avocados. Unsaturated fats generally come from vegetarian sources and tend to increase HDL, the good cholesterol, while lowering the LDL. Most doctors recommend that patients eat more unsaturated fats. Trans fats are the fats which are normally liquid at room temperature, but have been chemically modified to be solid at room temperature through the process of hydrogenation. Trans fats are used in food manufacturing to improve shelf life and enhance taste and texture. Trans fats are frequently found in processed foods, including margarine. Trans fats tend to increase LDL and lower HDL, so completely avoiding trans fats is recommended. How do you know if you're eating trans fats? Check nutrition labels for any hydrogenated or partially hydrogenated ingredients. Even if something's advertised as no trans fats, if you see hydrogenated anywhere in the ingredients, avoid it. For CardioSmart, I'm Dr. Martha Galati.
So once again, one of the reasons why those saturated fats are so bad for you is that they contain hydrogenated fats. This is not good for you. And what they do is they raise the blood cholesterol levels in your blood. They clog up your arteries and they increase the risk of heart disease. So none of that is good. And you find them, of course, in animal fats and beef, veal, lamb, pork, some poultry, butter, cream, ice cream, and cheeses. So those are really high in saturated fats. And you also have different types of vegetable oils that I mentioned before, but they're coconut oil and palm oil. These are not ones that you want to use. And also cocoa butter. So you want to go sort of low or a lot less on saturated fats. So you want to choose the right kinds of fats. And these would be beans and fish and poultry, and they provide plenty of protein without much saturated fats. You want to steer clear of those fatty meats, the juicy steaks, and use whole milk dairy products sparingly. Now, I mentioned before a term, trans fats. This is in the news quite recently. So what are they? Well, they're fats that are man-made and artificially created through a chemical process in a lab. And that adds hydrogen to liquid vegetable oil, and that allows the fats to become solid. So why do they use them? I always say follow the money. Well, they're inexpensive to produce. They're easy to use in manufacturing, and they increase the shelf life of a product so it doesn't go bad quickly. Sometimes some of those products, those crackers and cookies, they can last for a couple of years. And they also increase the flavor stability of oils and foods, which makes the foods not deteriorate so much, and it continues to taste well. Now, here are some names for trans fats. So you need to check the labels for this. Well, one of them is hydrogenated vegetable oil, partially hydrogenated vegetable oil, vegetable shortening, and margarine. And I'm sure there's products that I have at home that contain all of those, but I use them sparingly. Now, the next video is on trans fats, and it'll give you a quick overview of what they are and where they're found. Let's take a look at this one on trans fats.
It's the type of fat that spells double trouble for your heart.
Trans fat lowers your HDL, which is your good cholesterol, and it raises your LDL, which is your bad cholesterol. So all in all, trans fat increases your risk of heart disease.
Manufactured by adding hydrogen to vegetable oil to make it solid at room temperature, trans fat extends the shelf life of food, such as certain baked goods, chips, refrigerated dough, non-dairy creamer, margarine, and some fried foods. Mayo Clinic dietitian Anya Guy says it's important to read ingredient labels and look for partially hydrogenated vegetable oil. When eating out, choose baked or grilled protein options. And instead of those cookies or chips that could be loaded with trans fat,
rather than choosing snacks in the packaged aisle, choose carrots and ranch or apples and peanut butter as a snack.
In the end, your heart will thank you for it. For the Mayo Clinic News Network, I'm Jason Howland.
So you might be wondering, well, what's the big problem with using trans fats? Well, they raise your blood cholesterol, which is the bad part, and that is the LDL, and they lower your HDL, which are the good cholesterol levels. And then eating trans fat foods increases your risk of developing heart disease and stroke. I sound like a broken record when I talk about this, but high levels of cholesterol can really bring us to have more cardiovascular problems. So if you're wondering, well, where are those trans fats foods? Well, they're in the frying oil in many, if not all, fast food restaurants. They're in French fries, fried chicken, fried fish, fried foods at the fairs that you eat. Notice the term fried, and also in some processed foods. It used to be that they were in a lot of the crackers and stuff, but they're definitely in fried chicken. So trans fats are processed foods. They can be in your margarines that you pick up at the grocery store, in vegetable shortening. My mom used to use vegetable shortening to cook everything. But they're also in ice cream, so check the labels. They're kind of disguised. They put them in puddings and pudding mixes and ready-made pies and also those cookies, cakes and candy, and also cake mixes and the frosting that you buy to put on the cake. They're also in refrigerated biscuit mix and frozen pizza. They can be in those crackers and potato chips, fritters, and donuts. Notice those are fried. Crackers aren't, but they put them in crackers to extend the shelf life. And they're also in gravy and sauces, mixes, artificial creamers, and in microwave popcorn. Now, many of the manufacturers have pulled the trans fats out of some of these products, so make sure that you check the labels. So let's take a look at cholesterol. This is part of the fat family. So cholesterol is a fat-like substance. It's found in animal tissue. And cholesterol actually is manufactured in our bodies. It's in the liver. If you have too much cholesterol in your body, however, it can build up in the walls of your arteries as plaque and eventually harden. And this buildup increases the mobility of heart disease. So a typical Sunday breakfast at a fast food restaurant, or a restaurant, I should say, a sit-down restaurant, might be one of those that you see right there, would have the eggs, the sausage, the bacon. I think that's fries over there. But there are some redeeming values in there. You can see an orange slice and a little bit of cantaloupe. So make sure you don't leave that on the plate when you have your Sunday breakfast. Let's take a look at this next video called What is Cholesterol? And see why we needed to have some cholesterol, but not a lot of it. Let's look at this one.
Cholesterol is a waxy, fat-like substance that your body produces naturally, mostly in your liver. Sounds gross, but your body can't function without it. You need cholesterol to make hormones like estrogen and testosterone. It's also a key ingredient in cortisol, which helps control inflammation. Without cholesterol, you can't make vitamin D from sunlight. And it helps create bile acid so you can digest fat. Cholesterol is in every single cell, building healthy cell membranes in your brain, nerves, muscles, skin, and organs. The best part is that your body makes all the cholesterol you need on its own. But cholesterol also comes from foods like meat and dairy products. And when you eat things high in saturated and trans fats, like animal products and processed foods, your liver produces even more cholesterol. Too much cholesterol causes plaque to build up in your arteries, making it harder for your heart to pump blood to your body. Plaque can also cause blood clots to form, which can lead to heart attack or stroke. So as you can see, it's important to keep your cholesterol levels healthy and balanced to keep you feeling your best.
So I highly recommend that all of us know and take a cholesterol test. So to find out what your cholesterol levels are, you need to have a blood test. And there are three numbers to look at, primarily. LDL, the HDL, and the triglycerides. So you want to take a look at those total numbers that you get. If your total number is 240 and higher, well, that means that you have a high risk for heart problems and plaque. If you are 200 to 239, then you're borderline high. And then if you're less than 200, that is a desirable cholesterol number. Now, breaking that apart, let's take a look at LDL. This is termed the low-density lipoprotein. And this is noted as the bad cholesterol. I always think of this as L for lousy. It can build up on the walls of your arteries and form a thick, hard plaque that blocks the flow of blood to your heart and to your brain. Now, looking at the LDL numbers, the optimal number for that is 100, and a higher number of 190 or above represents a high risk for heart disease. Now, let's take a look at the HDL. This is the good cholesterol, and it's called the high-density lipoprotein, H for healthy. This type of cholesterol is actually good for you. It helps eliminate the bad cholesterol from the body, kind of like acts as a scavenger, and that returns it to the liver. So looking at some of the HDL numbers, the optimal number would be 60 and above. Well, you know, it's within reason above. The higher the number, the lower your risk for heart disease. Now, the high risk would be less than 40 for men and less than 50 for women. Now, that third number are called the triglycerides. Now, the body converts excess calories, sugar, and alcohol into those triglycerides that is then carried in the blood and stored in the fat cells throughout the body. And there are some numbers here for you to know about. If you have a triglyceride number of 500 and above, that's considered to be very high risk. 200 to 499 is a high risk, and 150 to 199 is borderline high risk. If your triglyceride number is less than 150, then you're apparently normal. So that's good, that's what you're shooting for. So when you take a look at high cholesterol, remember that it's one of the major risk factors for coronary heart disease, heart attacks, and stroke. And almost 20% of all strokes and over 50% of all heart attacks can be linked to high cholesterol. Now, before I leave the topic of cholesterol, I wanted to remind us to find out what our personal cholesterol numbers are. We should get them now, whatever age you are, so that you can track them throughout your lifetime. And remember to always choose foods that are lower in the cholesterol numbers so that you're very comfortable and you're a lot more healthy. Now, if your cholesterol numbers are really, really high, your doctor may suggest that you go on some type of medication. And I'm not a doctor, a physician that is, and I don't recommend it one way or the other, but I want you to really take that advice and also think about it and don't do everything the doctor tells you right away, because you might have some lifestyle changes that you can do to lower your cholesterol without going on medication. Because any medication that you go on is going to have side effects. Okay, let's move on to number three, and that's protein. So the amino acids are the building blocks of proteins, and these are needed for your muscles, your blood, skin, hair, nails, and internal organs. Protein builds and repairs your muscles, and it can also be used as a source of energy, but only if there are not enough carbohydrates and fats available. So that's the third energy source that's used up in the body. Now, next to water, protein is the most plentiful substance in the body, and most of it is actually in the skeletal muscles. The needs that you have for protein will vary according to your age, your weight, and your activity level, as well as your gender. And women, generally speaking, need about 50 grams of protein every day, and men about 60. Now, there are lots of sources for protein. The most common ones would be meats, including seafood, fish, turkey, chicken, and tuna, as well as dairy products, and eggs, and non-meats, which would be nuts and beans, quinoa, lentils, and tofu. And you can combine some of those foods like rice and beans, milk and wheat cereal, corn and beans to make a complete amino acid, just like eating the meat would be like chicken and turkey and fish, because they have all of the amino acids. So let's take a look at a product, salmon. Salmon has about 185 calories in a serving, and it has 34 grams of protein, 18 grams of fat, and four of them are saturated. So that's pretty good. So let's take a look at this next video, which will give us some sources of healthy protein. And these are also some alternatives that you can consider when you want to make sure that you're getting enough protein in your daily diet. Let's take a look.
Hi everyone, my name is Caitlin and I'm a nutrition expert here at Vanderbilt Health. So a lot of people think that protein is bad for them or we can only get protein from meat sources. However, protein is very healthy and there's lots of different foods out there aside from meat that are really great sources of protein. Lean ground beef is low in fat, low in cholesterol, and a great source of protein. 3 ounces has about 25 grams of protein. So the second one is Greek yogurt. 1 cup is low in fat and has 15 grams of protein, so another great protein source. Now I also love hard-boiled eggs. 1 medium-sized hard-boiled egg has about 6 grams of protein. I love boiling my eggs at nighttime, throwing them into the refrigerator, and grabbing them on my way to work. It makes for a perfect on-the-go mid-morning snack. Lentils are actually very delicious and a great source of protein. 1/2 cup of cooked lentils has about 12 grams of protein. So substitute that lean beef in your tacos for some lentils and call them lentil tacos. So remember to incorporate protein into your meals and snacks. Just be mindful about choosing the lower in fat version. For more tips on healthy living and healthier recipes, log on to mysouthernhealth.com.
Now, I don't know if you know much about this next type of protein that I'm going to talk about, but it's if you're in the gym circles, then you probably know a lot about it. It's called whey. It's W-H-E-Y. It's commonly used as a supplement for athletic performance, and you add it, it's a powder, and you add it to shakes, and you consume it before or after vigorous exercise. This is not just like a walk around the block type of supplement. It comes with liquid extract that results from making cheese. And the liquid is then dried, producing a powdered protein supplement. There are so many different types of whey protein that are available in these great big huge tubs because athletes use them all the time. Bodybuilders also use it. But you know what? Some researchers with a nonprofit organization called Clean Label Project found some toxins in many of the protein powder products that they tested. So I wanted you to take a look at this report on protein powders, and of course, the study has been refuted by the manufacturers. You can decide after you watch this video called New Report Ranks Protein Powders. Let's take a look at this one.
So many of us reach for protein powder for a morning smoothie or shake.
A new report by a nonprofit organization found that toxins in many of the products that were tested. Our Julia Fellow shows us the protein shakes with the best and worst results in this exclusive report. Julia, good morning.
Good morning to you, Vince and Susan. Yeah, there were some really great results, but there were also some pretty bad ones from this nonprofit group that partnered with a laboratory. They found toxins inside that include cadmium, which is a component in battery acid, and also arsenic, an active ingredient in rat poison, mercury, and even lead. Whether it is for losing weight or bulking up, so many of you have made drinking a protein shake part of your routine at daybreak. Leaders with a nonprofit Clean Label Project wanted to test what may be hiding behind those labels. They teamed up with an independent third-party analytical chemistry laboratory called Ellipse Analytics. Ellipse is an accredited lab out of Colorado.
Sample needed to be prepared just like a serving, just like how you would make your morning smoothie.
Clean Label Project Executive Director Jacqueline Bowen was stunned when the results showed more than 50% of the products tested had measurable levels of BPA.
BPA is known as an endocrine disruptor. An endocrine disruptor is a chemical that acts like a hormone in your system.
The results were based on star ratings for overall purity. One star is below average, and five stars is above average. The brands with the best ranking of five stars were Biochem, Gero Formulas, and Puri.
Oftentimes, that suggests that the brand is doing additional diligence when it comes to ingredient sourcing and doing actual testing to make sure that their products have lower levels.
The five-star brands had two things in common. They were whey or dairy-based and were vanilla-flavored.
Plant-based protein powders were by far the dirtiest and most contaminated. And we also found that products that were chocolate-based happen to have higher levels of heavy metals. What exactly the root cause of this is still uncertain.
At the bottom was the brand Vega with 1.2 stars. 11 of their products tested came back with the highest amount of toxic metals, which include arsenic, mercury, cadmium, and lead.
There is no safe levels of lead because of the ability to cause long-term adverse health effects.
Three protein powders sold by Sun Warrior scored second lowest with 1.7 stars.
Compared to the other products tested, they had elevated levels of heavy metals.
And Garden of Life's five products tested had the third lowest score with 1.8 stars.
Organic plant formula, chocolate raw, chocolate cacao raw, you know, so that's, I bet you that's the one that's overall bringing this brand down.
They hope testing what's behind the label helps consumers see past the flashy marketing and feel empowered. Of the three products that we mentioned that got less than two stars, we got a response only from Garden of Life. A spokesperson wrote in part, "We continue to dig into the methodology of this recent study. Our proteins are the cleanest, most thoroughly tested, third-party inspected, and certified products available on the market. We are open, transparent, and most of all, clean." There are also many other recognizable brands like Nature's Best and Quest that were tested in this study. We have all the results for you in my story that's on TMJ4.com. You just have to click on the link that's embedded in the web script. Reporting live in Glendale, Julia Fellow, today's TMJ4.
So now maybe you've decided, well, I'm not going to eat meat anymore and I want to become a vegetarian. Let's talk about that. So vegetarians do not eat animal products, and there are many different types of niches or segments in vegetarianism. There's the lacto, which allows dairy. The ovo allows eggs. Lacto-ovo allows dairy and eggs. Pescatarian or pescarian allows fish. No, it's pescatarian, that's what it's called, pescatarian, and that allows fish. Now, vegan diets are totally plant-based and do not include, generally speaking, eggs. Oh, these are vegans. They don't include eggs, dairy products of any kind, and that also includes fish and chicken, and they don't eat honey either. And sometimes the really strict vegans don't wear any clothing that is made of animal products. So let's take a look at this next video in What is a Vegan? And see what foods are actually eaten on this diet. I think you'll be quite surprised. Let's take a look.
It is no wonder why vegans are one of the hottest diet topics for many people, for many different reasons. Some do it for animals, some do it for the environment, and others for health reasons. Unfortunately, following a diet based exclusively on plants may put some people at a higher risk of nutrient deficiencies. This is especially true when vegan diets are not well planned. In this video, I will give you healthy foods that vegans can consume to obtain all the protein, vitamins, minerals, and other nutrients needed for optimal health. Vegans do not eat meat, fish, eggs, dairy products, or any foods containing them. A vegan diet relies on plant-based foods, including fruits, vegetables, grains, beans, nuts, and seeds. A vegan diet can be a healthful and nutritionally adequate diet. However, a vegan must make sure they eat enough foods with protein, calcium, iron, vitamin B12, and omega-3 fatty acids. Here's what vegans do eat. Number 1. Fruits and vegetables. Fruits and veggies are probably the most common and frequent food category that vegans eat, as they offer many different choices to try, besides their high vitamin content. Single fruits, salads, veggie sticks, dips, stir-fried veggies are just a few of the many choices you can eat as a vegan. Number 2. Beans and legumes. Since the vegan diet completely lacks any animal protein, beans and legumes can function as good protein replacements. You can eat, for example, white beans, kidney beans, peas, black-eyed peas, chickpeas, lentils, broad beans, and other legumes for your daily protein intake. Number 3. Soy products. Soy is very popular in vegan diets because it is a high protein and very versatile food that is used to make soy milk, tofu, yogurts, cheese, and other soy products you can use in all your main meals like breakfasts, salads, sandwiches, and desserts. Look up in your local health food store or supermarket and you'll find plenty of soy products to incorporate into your vegan meals. Number 4. Grains. Grains like oatmeal, breads, tortillas, and pastas are great sources of carb and fiber, which aid digestion and keep you feeling fuller for longer. However, it's best to go for whole wheat grains and not refined ones, as these are the healthiest and contain the most nutrients. Number 5. Other extra foods. Other foods that you can eat in a vegan diet to increase your energy and nutrient intake are nuts and seeds or spreads, like popcorn, pumpkin seeds, pecans, sprouts, and so on. Hummus, tahini, and nut butters will also help spike your protein levels, besides making ordinary veggies taste more filling. Supplements. A vitamin that many vegans tend to lack, and perhaps you've already heard of, is B12. B12 is commonly found in most animal protein sources, so when people are switching to a full vegan diet, the levels of this vitamin will inevitably drop. However, you could take it by consuming fermented and fortified foods or diet supplements that contain B12.
So our fourth group of nutrients are called vitamins. Now, vitamins are not necessarily a source of energy like a food would be, but they do regulate chemical reactions in the body, and the body does not manufacture these vitamins. We get vitamins from the foods we eat and from taking supplements. And remember, no one food contains all the vitamins required by the body every day. So we have two different kinds of vitamins. They're called water and fat soluble vitamins. 13 are classified as either water soluble, such as C and B complex, or fat soluble, such as A, D, E, and K. So it gets a little complicated, and this is not a course in all these vitamins. I'm just giving you an overview. So I've selected the next video. It's a great discussion on vitamins and how they work. And this is a TED production, and it's entitled, How Do Vitamins Work? Let's take a look and learn something.
A, C, E, D, B, K. No, this isn't some random out-of-order alphabet. These are vitamins. And just like letters build words, they're the building blocks that keep the body running. Vitamins are organic compounds we need to ingest in small amounts to keep functioning. They're the body's builders, defenders, and maintenance workers, helping it to build muscle and bone, make use of nutrients, capture and use energy, and heal wounds. If you need convincing about vitamin value, just consider the plight of olden day sailors who had no access to vitamin-rich fresh produce. They got scurvy, But vitamin C, abundant in fruits and vegetables, was the simple antidote to this disease. While bacteria, fungi, and plants produce their own vitamins, our bodies can't, so we have to get them from other sources. So how does the body get vitamins from out there into here? That's dependent on the form these compounds take. Vitamins come in two types, lipid-soluble and water-soluble, and the difference between them determines how the body transports and stores vitamins and gets rid of the excess. The water solubles are vitamin C and B complex vitamins that are made up of eight different types that each do something unique. These are dissolved in the watery parts of fruits, vegetables, and grains, meaning their passage through the body is relatively straightforward. Once inside the system, these foods are digested, and the vitamins within them are taken up directly by the bloodstream. Because blood plasma is water-based, water-soluble vitamins C and B have their transport cut out for them and can move around freely within the body. For lipid-soluble vitamins, dissolved in fat and found in foods like dairy, butter, and oils, this trip into the blood is a little more adventurous. These vitamins make it through the stomach and the intestine, where an acidic substance called bile flows in from the liver, breaking up the fat and preparing it for absorption through the intestinal wall. Because fat-soluble vitamins can't make use of the blood's watery nature, they need something else to move them around. And that comes from proteins that attach to the vitamins and act like couriers, transporting fat solubles into the blood and around the body. So this difference between water or fat-soluble vitamins determines how they get into the blood, but also how they're stored or ejected from the body. The system's ability to circulate water-soluble vitamins in the bloodstream so easily means that most of them can be passed out equally easily via the kidneys. Because of that, most water-soluble vitamins need to be replenished on a daily basis through the food we eat. But fat-soluble vitamins have staying power because they can be packed into the liver and in fat cells. The body treats these parts like a pantry, storing the vitamins there and rationing them out when needed, meaning we shouldn't overload on this type of vitamin because the body is generally well-stocked. Once we've figured the logistics of transport and storage, the vitamins are left to do the work they came here to do in the first place. Some, like many of the B-complex vitamins, make up coenzymes, whose job it is to help enzymes release the energy from food. Other B vitamins then help the body to use that energy. From vitamin C, you get the ability to fight infection and make collagen, a kind of tissue that forms bones and teeth and heals wounds. Vitamin A helps make white blood cells, key in the body's defense, helps shape bones, and improves vision by keeping the cells of the eye in check. Vitamin D gathers calcium and phosphorus so we can make bones. And vitamin E works as an antioxidant, getting rid of elements in the body that can damage cells. Finally, from vitamin K, we score the ability to clot blood, since it helps make the proteins that do this job. Without this vitamin variety, humans face deficiencies that cause a range of problems, like fatigue, nerve damage, heart disorders, or diseases like rickets and scurvy. On the other hand, too much of any vitamin can cause toxicity in the body. So there goes the myth that loading yourself with supplements is a great idea. In reality, it's all about getting the balance right and hitting that vitamin jackpot.
So you might have decided, well, I need a vitamin supplement or a multivitamin supplement. Well, when you start making those decisions that you're going to go out and look for one, you need to find one that's going to fit your own particular needs. So a vitamin and mineral supplement provides a variety of nutrients that are also found in foods, which is why sometimes it is not recommended that you have one if you're eating the proper diet. Now, some people need a supplement because they don't eat a variety of foods. Maybe they have allergies or they eat a vegetarian diet. So these supplements come in many different forms. You've got pills, capsules, chewable tablets, gels, powders, and liquids. There is a great variety of supplements on the market. It's a multi-billion dollar business. So whether you take a vitamin or not, you need to discuss that with your doctor and make sure you read the labels and get ones that are quality. Oftentimes, you're paying a little more for quality ones, but then again, you're not going to have any type of impurities in your vitamins or minerals that you select. So I don't know if you really need to have a vitamin supplement, maybe not, but This next video is going to discuss vitamins and supplements and gives you some more tips on selecting the right vitamins that will be just for you. Let's take a look.
The rows of choices are endless. But before you start taking over-the-counter supplements, pharmacists say make sure you read the label.
A large misconception is because something is natural that it's safe, which is not always the case.
These are the labels you want to look for.
So there are certain seals of approval on things that are available over the counter. And the biggest one is the United States Pharmacopeia. So they review the things that are available for their potency, their ingredients, so those are a little bit safer for people to take.
And these are the words you want to avoid.
There are certain things to watch out for. If something claims that it is the best, it's going to give you fast results, it's going to be a quick fix, those are things that, you know, you may want to steer clear of.
And when it comes to reading the label, make sure you know what ingredients are being used.
Oftentimes people are taking other medications, either over-the-counter or prescription, or they have disease states that interact with the vitamins and supplements. So it really is patient-specific.
But depending on your health conditions, your diet, and lifestyle, health experts say you may not even need supplements.
If you are on a balanced diet and you are taking a bunch of vitamins every day, you're basically paying to have really expensive urine, because if you have too much of this stuff, you're not doing anything with it. It's just cycling right through your body.
Pregnant women, nursing mothers, vegetarians, senior citizens, and people with food allergies need to be taking supplements to maintain and improve their health. Before you start taking a supplement, it's important to talk to your doctor and know what you want to get out of the supplement. For Lee Health, I'm Lindsay Morton.
So back to water-soluble vitamins. Now, the B complex vitamins and vitamin C are water soluble, which means they're not stored in the body and they must be replaced every day. They're easily destroyed or washed away during food storage as well as preparation. Now, the vitamin B complex is really an important vitamin to have. It aids in cell health, growth of red blood cells, digestion, nerve function, and eyesight. The B complex group is found in a variety of foods. If you didn't choose a vitamin supplement, it's in cereal grains and meat, poultry, eggs, fish, milk, legumes, and fresh vegetables. And once again, it cannot be stored, that vitamin that is, cannot be stored in the body. Now, there are vitamin B complexes. There's B1, B2, B3, B5, B6, B7, B9, and B12. And each of those vitamins have a different function. So if you want more information about those, you have to delve into that. So vitamin C is another vitamin that is not able to be stored in the body. It is also wonderful. It's an antioxidant, which is why it's so important. It has positive effects on your skin health as well as your immune function. It helps in the absorption of iron and the formation of collagen. That's great for your skin, nails, and hair. Citrus fruits are good sources of vitamin C, but other fruits and vegetables are also good sources. So you have a lot of choices. You have broccoli, you have grapefruit, which is wonderful, limes, as well as tomatoes, and a lot of other ones. So let's move on to what's called the fat-soluble vitamins. Now, these small amounts of vitamins A, D, E, and K are needed to maintain your good health. The body doesn't need these vitamins every single day because it stores them in the liver when it's not being used. A cautionary point here is that mega doses of vitamin A, D, E, or K can be toxic and lead to health problems, and that's because it's stored in the liver and you don't need those every single day, but they're really important. So let's go on to vitamin D. This is a very important vitamin as well. It's also known as the sunshine vitamin because it's produced by the body in response to sunlight. It's essential to strong bones because it keeps the body using calcium and it contributes to the skin cell growth and metabolism. The symptoms of vitamin deficiency, unfortunately, are bone pain and muscle weakness. But for some people, their symptoms are so subtle that you don't know that you have a vitamin D deficiency. So to keep on track with vitamin D, you can have tuna, salmon, sardines, flounder, pork, beef liver, eggs, milk, cereal, ricotta cheese, shiitake, mushrooms, and other fortified foods with vitamin D. So you do have some other choices for that. So let's move on to number 5 on the nutrient list. It's the minerals. So minerals are called inorganic, and there's more than 60 of them in the body, but only 16 are considered essential. This is why you need to have a nutrition degree. Now, the functions of minerals, they help the body to regulate blood clotting, muscle contraction, heart rhythm, acid-base balance, and nerve impulse conduction. Examples of the minerals would be calcium, folic acid, copper, iron, magnesium, potassium, sodium, and zinc. Now, looking at calcium, this is the major component for our bones and teeth. Milk and other dairy products are good sources of calcium. Other sources would be broccoli, salmon, sardines, greens and legumes, tofu, and sesame seeds. They're all yummy, so try them all. So there are many sources of calcium, and let's take a look at the Mayo Clinic 1 minute and see how we can get more calcium into our diet and not necessarily use those types of dairy products. Let's take a look.
To keep your bones strong and prevent osteoporosis, your body needs a certain amount of calcium, in general between 1,000 and 1,200 milligrams a day.
So a glass of milk has about 300 milligrams. So 2 glasses of milk, a cup serving of yogurt, would give you almost 1,000 milligrams right there.
But what if eating or drinking dairy isn't an option?
If you can't take dairy products because of lactose intolerance or you have other dietary preferences that limit that, not to worry because there are so many other foods out there that have calcium.
Common alternatives to milk are almond milk and soy milk, particularly the kind that is calcium fortified. Certain vegetables are higher in calcium, like rhubarb, spinach, black-eyed peas, okra, and broccoli. Other options include tofu, hummus, sunflower seeds, calcium-fortified orange juice, shrimp, and canned sardines and salmon.
So there's a variety of ways you can get through dietary sources, foods that you like, but at the same time give you the calcium.
For the Mayo Clinic News Network, I'm Jason Howland.
So potassium is another mineral. I'm sure you've heard of potassium before. It's necessary for the body to maintain the balance of pH levels in our body fluids. It's also involved in regulating our blood pressure, aiding our bone mass, our nervous system, muscle function, and heart, kidney, and adrenal functions. The sources would be bananas, raisins, kale, soybeans, dairy, and spinach. And I just read that avocados have twice the amount of potassium as do bananas. But I think the avocados might have some more fat in there, so you can decide which one you want to use. Okay, moving to the last of our nutrients, water. I love talking about water. Now, water is so important to our body. It helps transport oxygen and nutrients to all of our cells. It carries away waste products. It aids in digestion. And I think, kind of importantly, it regulates our body temperature. And you might wonder, well, why am I saying water is so important? Well, it's because there is a great percentage of water, in your body. Your total body weight is about 60% to 70% water. Your brain is about 85% water. Your blood, 80%. 10 to 15% of your bones are water. 70% of your muscle. And 75% of your heart is water. So you can see that you need water in every cell of your body. And you need this every day. So you might be wondering, okay, well, how much water do you need every day? Well, they generally say 2 to 3 quarts of water. That's 64 to 96 ounces every day. But it depends, again, on your gender, your weight, and your activity level. And if your body may need more water if you're ill, if you're physically active, if you're in hot and humid weather, or if you're in high altitudes. I didn't know if you knew that. So you're probably wondering, okay, I want to know more specifics about how to calculate how much water I need to have every day. Well, it's a really simple formula. For every pound of body weight, you need half an ounce of fluid intake per day. So you take your body weight in pounds and divide it by 2. It's pretty easy, isn't it? So let me give you an example. If you weigh 140 pounds, you need half of your body weight in water, which would be 70 ounces. Now, what I think is a good idea for you to do is to measure out your daily water needs and just see how much that is. You can put it in different measuring cups and then add it all up and put it in different water containers, just so you get an idea visually of how much water that you have. And then if you have enough water bottles, you can just line them all up the night before and you can fill them up. Or if you have a water station around campus or at a work site or even in a mall, then you can fill it up there and you just keep track of how many times you filled your water bottle. So if you're not drinking enough water, you might suffer from dehydration. So you might have like mild to excessive thirst. You might just feel tired for no other reason because you don't have enough water. You're tired, you're dizzy, you might have a headache. You might have dry mouth. Your mouth might feel like it has cotton in it. There might be muscle weakness, and you're just not urinating enough. Those are some signs of dehydration. So we really need to stay hydrated all day long, but drinking plain water can just be boring. So in the next video, we're going to show you 5 ways to trick yourself into drinking more water, and that could help you out. Let's take a look.
Did you know the average person should consume between 9 and 13 cups of water in a day? That may sound overwhelming, but it's dependent on your age, activity level, and some medications that you take. I find water super beneficial when you're trying to lose weight. Drinking it throughout the day helps to keep you full for no calories. Here are 5 tips to trick you into drinking more water throughout the day. I find that drinking more water is super easy to do when you carry a tall drinking glass or a bottle with you. Sometimes one that fits easily into a purse or a backpack can be a simple solution. Consider trying zero-calorie drink mixes. They come in powdered and liquid options and are easy to take on the go. Looking for a more subtle flavor? Try adding fresh produce to your water. Lemons, limes, and even cucumbers give just a hint of flavor to a nice ice water. Unsweetened tea is a great option. All varieties, as long as it's unsweetened, is super hydrating and definitely provides an antioxidant benefit. Tea can have a diuretic effect, which means you might be using the bathroom more, but new studies show it's just as hydrating as water. Find normal water boring? You're in luck. Sparkling water is everywhere these days, and it still keeps you super hydrated. But be sure to check the label. You want to look for a sugar-free variety with no sodium for the best hydration option.
Okay, let's talk about tap water. So we all have running water in our homes, in our work sites, schools, malls, every place we go. And there are drinking fountains, there's at the airports, in the malls, and supermarkets. Sometimes you really have to search them out. But this tap water that you're drinking usually comes from one of two sources. Surface water from reservoirs, rivers, and lakes, and groundwater from an artesian and deep well. So they actually, thankfully, they process the tap water, but it undergoes an important disinfection process, and that destroys the most harmful organisms like bacteria and parasites. Now, the origin of your tap water and your purification levels can be located online, so you just have to go to your water company and go online. It'll tell you everything that you need to know about the water that's going into your home. And also, you can check for corroded and old pipes in your own dwelling. You can look under your sink to see if the pipes are corroded, or you could have somebody come out and inspect them and to see what the status is of your pipes. So let's take a look now at bottled water. So the U.S. public goes through about 50 billion water bottles a year. An estimated 40 to 50% or more of bottled water is really just tap water in a bottle. And many bottled water companies use water from public water sources, put it into plastic containers, and resell it at 2,900 times the price of regular tap water. So I'm sure you have many types or your own favorite type of water, and they go from the low end to the high end in price. So let's learn more about the dangers of plastic water bottles with Dr. Axe. He is really a cool guy. I think you'll really enjoy this next video.
Hey guys, Dr. Axe here, founder of DrAxe.com and Dr. Natural Medicine. Hey, I want to talk to you about the dangers of plastic bottles. Now, these are things that most people consume almost every day. I mean, whether you're stopping at a gas station or grocery store, lots of us are drinking it out of plastic. But here's what I want to tell you is that these plastics are not necessarily a natural material. What happens is they can accumulate toxins in our body over time, which have both foreseen and unforeseen consequences to our bodies. Here's some fast facts. Americans buy half a billion bottles of water every single week. That's enough to circle the globe 5 times, and it costs 2,000 times more than tap water. So again, bottled water is something that obviously is a more recent phenomenon, but again, these things are adding up and actually causing health issues in millions of people around the world. So let's talk about what's in bottled water and the risks. Number one, they contain hormone-disrupting chemicals. Now, most of us have heard by now of a compound called BPA, that's bisphenol A, and BPA has been shown to be an endocrine disruptor, okay? So this is gonna cause issues with hormones, whether it be estrogen and progesterone, testosterone. It's gonna throw off these hormones and cause issues like infertility, can increase PCOS, can cause low testosterone in men. You don't want to drink out of plastic bottles if you can help it, especially those with bisphenol A. But again, hormone disrupting chemicals, that's what's in our water. Number two, antimony trioxide. Now, antimony is a compound that's found in the earth. It's a metal element, but this is actually found in a lot of plastic bottles. So imagine that, you know, we've heard press on the dangers of mercury from silver fillings. We've heard the dangers of lead-based paints and eating those and being exposed. We've heard the, you know, also of even arsenic in some of our food supply. Well, antimony falls into the same category with those, to where if you have too much of it, it's neurotoxic, has been linked to heart and cardiovascular issues, liver issues, kidney issues, but it's a toxin to the body. And again, many of this is found in bottled water and antimony. Number three, there's been more than 25,000 chemicals discovered from what's, you know, a lot of times when we're buying bottled water, there's tap water in there, which there are more chemicals in there. But also, again, just the chemicals found in plastic alone are severely toxic to the body, and they're not natural for the body to handle. So really, it's causing liver toxicity. You may not realize this, but if your liver becomes overly toxic, it actually affects your hormones as well. Your liver is actually part of what filters out and detoxes excessive estrogen in the body. So hey, one of the biggest causes of infertility today in PCOS is when women get estrogen too high and progesterone gets too low. Well, if estrogen gets too high, your body needs to lower it. You know what? It can't do that when your liver's too toxic. So again, this contributes to that issue as well. Here are other bottled water risks. Plastic pollution. Think about what we're doing to our environment. Plastic does not degrade naturally as other things do over time. And so what it's gonna do, we're polluting the ocean, we're polluting the earth here as well. It's resource intensive. You know, the resources it's taking and what we're having to do to produce plastic can destroy the earth as well. And then also, there are safer solutions out there today. Think about this, especially when we're talking about drinking water and your own personal health and safety. It's easy to make the switch to glass or to stainless steel. And those are the two things in the Axe household we use every single day. You'll see lots of glass, lots of stainless steel, much healthier and safer options there as well. So listen, get rid of the plastic, get rid of the bisphenol A and the phthalates and all the other chemicals. Use glass, use stainless steel. By doing that, you're gonna avoid all of these environmental issues, all of these personal health risks as well. And hey, if you've enjoyed this live training video and appreciate the warning here about plastic, take a minute right now. Hey, make sure to subscribe here to my YouTube channel. Also, hey, I've got a lot more articles coming out. If you want help with any specific condition, just Google search my name, such as Dr. Axe PCOS, Dr. Axe Low Testosterone. I've written articles on almost every health issue you can imagine. Done a lot of videos here as well. So hey, search on YouTube my name, search on Google, and I think you'll find more information to help you reach your next level of health. Guys, thanks for watching. Remember, stay away from plastic bottles.
So I know that Dr. Axe gave you a lot of information on the dangers of water bottles. So I think it's really important for you to choose your water source each day. And it's good to be informed about the production of the tap water that you have, and also to know about some of the dangers of using plastic water bottles. Many times it's just a matter of convenience that you choose tap water, and then trying to figure out which bottled water to use is a big project. Sometimes you just choose whatever's cheapest. And carrying around a water container all day long is best, but it can be very clumsy and heavy. So we need to weigh the options and be informed. Let's look at the next video on the differences between tap water and bottled water. And this video is entitled, Tap Water Might Be Better Than Bottled Water. Let's take a look.
Turns out that tap water is a better choice than bottled water because tap water is actually regulated by government officials. The fact is that somebody is regulating drinking water. I've been in water treatment plants, watched government officials monitoring this water every single day. Bottled water is often just tap water packaged. They don't put it through any other kinds of tests. You can drink water free out of the tap, or you can put it in a bottle and pay 99 cents for a pint. The problem with bottled water is you're not only getting the tap water, you're also getting the plastic in the bottle, which is then, of course, leaching into the bottle, and you're getting that into your system. When I was growing up, nobody had plastic water bottles. Now everybody has plastic water bottles. The problem with these plastic water bottles is they are all made out of a chemical called phthalates, which are known hormone disruptors. They mess around with your endocrine system. So in other words, you can test your body before you drink a bottle of water and after you drink a bottle of water, and you can actually find quantifiable amounts of this plastic in your body. It's not like drinking a pint of water is going to be a problem, but if you're drinking bottled water day after day after day after day, you're going to actually see your so-called body burden start to rise. Now you combine that with the several dozen personal care products that you use in a given day. That could be lipstick, it could be shampoo, it could be mascara, it could be nail polish remover. All these things start to basically build up and accumulate. Your body's absorbing all of them. Very few of them have ever been tested individually for their effects on personal health. But one thing we're really certain about is they've never been tested in combination with each other. Buying filters is a great idea. Filters can always take out certain kinds of things, but as you know, the market has got lots of different kinds of filters. Some are very basic, cheap charcoal filters that'll take some of the odor out, for example. And then you can get all these reverse osmosis filters that are very, very expensive. But the truth is you're never going to be able to get everything out, because if we could, they would be taking that out at these municipal water treatment plants. You can't undo the problem once the problem is already out. It's kind of like closing the door after the horse has left the barn. Why is it that Manhattan has some of the cleanest drinking water in the United States? It's because where the water comes from, up in the Catskills and the Croton Reservoir, these are areas that are massively forested. What we want to do is be able to protect the source of our water, which is to say the forests that protect all the water that we drink.
Another alternative to tap and bottled water, actually it's a filtration process, is using a Brita pitcher. And usually you can use these at home or at your work site. It's a very popular water filtering pitcher. You can buy these online or at Target or Walmart or any place. It uses the pressure in your tap to force water through a non-woven material in a tightly bound carbon block. So that's the carbon is the filtration process. The filters reduce lead, chlorine, asbestos, benzene, particulates, and other contaminants, but not everything. It's sort of an expensive way to filter your water at home or at work, and it does take some maintenance, but certainly it is a choice. This next video I wanted you to see is, how do the Brita pitchers actually work? Let's take a look.
That water coming out of your tap isn't just water.
it could contain a cocktail of unhealthy ingredients, including heavy metals such as lead, copper, limescale, impurities, and anything else that the water can pick up from the pipes. If you could see the inside of these pipes, you'd be surprised. This is how Brita filtration can help. Maxtra Plus and Maxtra Plus limescale filters are made from activated carbon pearls and ion exchange pearls, which combine to efficiently trap and absorb heavy metals such as lead and copper, limescale and other impurities. They also reduce substances that impair taste, like chlorine compounds. Both the Maxtra Plus and Maxtra Plus limescale filters are extremely effective, but there is a difference between them. The Maxtra Plus limescale filter is the premium filter of the two, with 50% better limescale reduction power, while still providing effective reduction of heavy metals such as lead and copper, chlorine, and other impurities. What's left is water that tastes great and is better for all of you. Transform your water. Protect your family. Brita water tastes better.
So taking a look at another type of filtering system, we can look at a, sort of a Brita-like pitcher that keeps you can keep it on the counter and or in the refrigerator, and that'll serve your whole family. And but you do have to refill it when the water supply goes low, and when you fill up your water bottles every day, you need to fill up your Brita. Or you can choose another type of filtering system that is more permanent. And this next video is going to discuss tap and bottled water and the problems associated with these choices. So let's look at how to choose a water filter. I think you'll find this to be very interesting.
Here you go, Kev.
Ah, thank you, Richard. But before I take a sip, is it filtered?
Yes.
Good, because you know a lot of people are concerned about the quality of their tap water, so they're always thinking about how do I filter it?
I know many people are. 90% of American houses get their water out of a public water supply.
Wow, that's high.
It's perfectly safe. Yeah. And but they're still worried. They still go out and get cases of this bottled water. Mm-hmm. But there's no guarantee that this is any better, because this is just many times water that comes out of a tap and gets filtered. It doesn't
really all
come out of a spring.
Just tap water in a bottle.
That's right. So they want to find a level of safety. So at the least case, you'll see them do this.
Sure.
They get a filter like this, and they'll pour tap water in.
Right.
And what that water does, it goes down through a cartridge like this that's got granulated activated carbon. Mm-hmm. And that's going to clean up taste and odor and some chlorine.
Yeah, so that's great, except that you don't get any volume out of this.
That's
this
right.
thing's filled up and it's
Seems
empty.
Like it's always empty.
Right?
Yeah.
It's true.
Right. So what you can do is take the same technology, put it at the end of a faucet right here on the spout.
Right.
So you can see right here that this is just going to come out when you're washing the dishes. You turn it this way when you want to have filtered water to drink.
Perfect.
Okay?
Just what you need.
Right. Now, you can also get this level of technology in a filter that fits underneath the sink. So right here, you'd have a series of cartridges right here with a separate faucet right here.
Oh, nice.
Okay, so instead of it coming through the spout, it would come through right here.
And you can do away with this thing
right
here.
That's right. This doesn't always look good in everybody's kitchen.
Yeah, understood. All right.
So, but you can also go one level higher under the kitchen sink, and this is called a reverse osmosis filter. Now, RO means tap water comes in this way through a series of cartridges, a pre-filter, and then this middle one is this. It's got a membrane. And now that water passes through this membrane. The holes in this membrane are so small, the only thing you can get through is pure H2O molecules.
Right. Water only.
No impurities. So what happens is it pushes through into this tank. You're going to make 8, 9, 10 gallons a day that are going to sit right here. And then for every gallon you make here, 1 or 2 gallons are going to go down the drain of impure water.
So incredibly pure, but
right.
again, not a lot of volume,
that's
and
right.
we get some waste
right.
with it.
Right.
All right.
So that's going to handle the water regionally over here.
A I always point like of to, use, right?
I like to see some sort of whole house filter at the least case. So this is a pre-filter that's going to come into the house right here. You can see there's different cartridges that can fit inside it. This is the polyester one.
Yep.
Look at this right here. This is the same filter about 30 days in.
Oh, that used to look like that?
That's iron that's gone into
After
there.
After 30 days.
That's right. And this is one that's got granulated activated carbon
yeah.
for chlorine and taste and odor.
So point of excuse me, this comes near the main, so
yep.
every drop of water that goes through the
that's
house
right.
goes through this
that's
filter.
Right. Now sooner or later it's going to clog, so I always like seeing this piping arrangement right here, which is a bypass.
Nice.
So if this starts to clog, at least for that period, you can open it.
Shut this off,
but
open
remember, that. Remember, in most houses, 40 to 50 gallons a day per person comes into that building for flushing of toilets and for showering and everything else.
And as you just pointed out, this happened in 30 days, so running down to the basement every
month. That's right. So depending how bad the water is. So here's another pre-filter right here I like. The water comes in through here, and you can see there's a screen right here in a particular micron that you can order. Mm-hmm. And now if it clogs, you can see it getting clogged, but instead of a filter that has to be replaced, this can actually back flush and flush it automatically. So at least you know you've got a high level of filtration for all the water coming
out. Does away with the filters, perfect. Yeah. But it sounds to me like these things are catching what? Sediment, things like iron.
That's
what if I'm dealing with odor or taste or soft, hard water?
Well, there reaches a point that some of these small solutions are not enough of an answer, and you should go out and get your water tested.
So I know exactly what's
Absolutely.
Coming in my house.
A certified state lab or a good outfit that knows what they're doing with water. And once you do, now you can go to a whole house filter like this. And the only question is going to be is what is inside this canister? You know, if you look inside it, you might see that you need to have sediment, sand, anthracite coal. This could be granulate activated carbon, garnet. If you got really acidic water, you might have limestone in there.
Right.
And so you're going to know what to put in there based on what that test tells you.
So you got just the right recipe for your water, and then everything's perfectly
clean. That's right.
Perfect, Richard. I love it. Now I want that
now
glass of
thirsty.
Water.
Now you're thirsty. Come on.
So another choice you might have in your home or at your work is called reverse osmosis. Now, this is a filtration process that's installed in your dwelling. This water treatment process removes contaminants from the water by using pressure, just like the Brita pitcher does, to force the water molecules through a semi-permeable membrane. This is a lot more sophisticated, though, and it takes out a lot more of the contaminants. There are some benefits to using this type of reverse osmosis. Now, the contaminants that are left behind are flushed down the drain. So the products, it produces clean water, comes right out of your tap that's hooked up to your reverse osmosis machine. It's automated, safe and effective, and it's easy to clean and to service. And they're reasonably priced, but they do cost some amount of money, and the maintenance is either annual or semi-annual. Now, the next video explains how reverse osmosis systems work. I think it's very interesting to know that somebody actually created this type of filtration process. It's on the market, and many different companies have this type of product, so you might want to check it out. So this one's called How Reverse Osmosis Really Works. Let's take a look.
If you've been searching for a high-quality drinking water system, you've probably heard the words reverse osmosis. It's kind of hard to explain how reverse osmosis works, but essentially it means that there is a membrane in the water system that lets clean water pass through the water element and sends water impurities down the drain. Reverse osmosis is the only effective way to remove microscopic impurities without using expensive filters, which must be frequently replaced and are wasteful to the environment. This makes clean, great-tasting water for your family's needs. This includes cooking, drinking, pets, and plants. You will notice your ice cubes will be clear and white. You're only getting half the benefit if you fill your glass with clean, delicious water, then put regular tap water ice cubes in your glass. And because your drinking water system produces all the water you will need, you won't have to worry about running low. We promise you will absolutely love your drinking water system. Nothing else even comes close. Remember, just because your water looks clear does not mean it is clean. Call today to find out more.
So we've been talking a little bit about bottled water. And then bottled water is generally in plastic. Now, plastic is everywhere. It's like we're a plastic society. We use it almost every day. It's in grocery receipts, water bottles, food packaging, and BPA, which is what I want to talk about next, is in many plastics, although the manufacturers have really begun to eliminate this chemical in its products. So what it's called is bisphenol A, which is BPA. That's why they have an acronym. It's used primarily in the production of polycarbonate plastics, which make up many food and beverage storage containers. That's important, and it's also used in epoxy resins, which line the aluminum cans and metal lids that you might have in your cupboard right now. I don't know if you knew that before. BPA is oftentimes lining those soups, beans, any type of canned food. Unless the product says non or no BPA, then it probably has that. So The problem with BPA is that it is a chemical, and they have found that that chemical leaches or seeps into the food and gets into your body. And then, of course, it might have serious health consequences, especially if you use a lot of those products with plastic. So when you look at water bottles and BPA, never, never, never refill a plastic water bottle. It's meant for one use only. You use it and toss it. The plastic seeps into the water and may cause health problems if you use it repeatedly. You might think you're saving money, but you're only harming your health. The better thing to do would be to use stainless steel containers or BPA-free plastic water containers. And they will tell you that there's no BPA in the product because those manufacturers are very proud of that. But you can also find BPA in other types of products. One of them is it's on shiny paper. Now, BPA leaches from that shiny paper and those other products, and that goes right into your skin. And unfortunately, it gets stored in the human body. And it's a known endocrine hormone disrupting chemical. Everybody talks about BPA. So when you go to the gas station, for an example, and you get that receipt, that probably has BPA residue on it. And one of the other precautions I wanted to tell you about is that you don't use microwave polycarbonate plastic food containers or use plastic wrap over your foods when you're heating them up. They have microwave lids now that you can use, or use a paper towel. The plastic containers have recycle codes on the bottom. Some, not all, plastics that are marked with recyclable codes 3 and 7 may be made with BPA. So you have to look at a chart, which makes us do more work, but there's actually a plastic resins codes chart that you can read. And then when you flip over your plastic container, your plastic bottle, you can see the number that's on there, and you can see if it's safe for you. And unfortunately, we do have a lot of unsafe products that are out there, so we do have to be aware. Now, the toxic chemical has been linked to reproductive problems, immunity, and neurological problems, as well as an increased likelihood of Alzheimer's, childhood asthma, metabolic disease, type 2 diabetes, and cardiovascular disease. Now, I don't think one exposure or a few exposures of BPA are going to cause any of those. But if it goes on for months, years of use, then you might be exposed to it and it's still in your system. So I wanted to let you know that there are physicians called functional doctors that can test you for these types of particles that are in your body, including lead and arsenic. And it's a special kind of testing, and it's not a regular type of test, it's specialized testing, but they're called functional doctors, and you can just Google them and see if there's one that's close to where you live. So now I want you to take a look at this next video, which talks about the problems associated with plastic, and it's called The Dangerous Chemicals in Your Plastic Packages. Let's take a look.
There's been a lot of buzz about dubious chemicals in the environment that might contribute to some pretty frightening stuff like obesity, breast cancer, thyroid issues, and they seem to lurk everywhere. In pesticides, cosmetics, and especially plastic packaging. In light of this, it's understandable to start panicking. But before you do, let's hear what molecular biologist Bruce Bloomberg has to say on the subject. He's been studying the link between synthetic chemicals and obesity for around 15 years. So he might be able to give us a better idea of what's really going on and what to do about it. Bad news is, Bloomberg confirmed that, yep, we're surrounded by these chemicals. One of the most well-known is BPA, or bisphenol A, which shows up in water bottles, cans, milk cartons, and more.
You get them from thermal paper receipts. Like I have these receipts from a recent trip. All of these things are coated with bisphenol A. And it goes right into your skin.
BPA has been making headlines for years about whether or not it's harming us. And while FDA-funded and independent studies have conflicting conclusions, the bigger heart of the issue is this. BPA is hard to get away from because it's a key building block in the tough, clear, flexible plastic called polycarbonate. And that proximity to food is what concerns scientists like Bloomberg.
You don't want to store food in plastics because some fraction of those plastics will leach into your food.
The BPA molecules that make up plastic are bound together by what's called an ester bond, which is extremely sensitive to heat. So when you heat up your food in plastic, that heat breaks some of the bonds, releasing the chemicals into your food. A survey by the CDC of 2,517 people estimated that over 90% of Americans have detectable levels of BPA in their urine. And BPA isn't alone. Phthalates, which make plastic flexible, can also leach into food when heated. And reviews of hundreds of studies have linked BPA and phthalates to heart disease, obesity, and type 2 diabetes. Not to mention, a 2015 review linked phthalates with impaired neurological development in children, which in 2018 prompted the American Academy of Pediatrics to announce that families should avoid plastic food containers entirely. And other studies on animals, like mice and monkeys, have shown that these chemicals can lead to problems in the lungs, brains, and reproductive organs. This is about the time someone like me would probably panic. But there are ways you can avoid these chemicals. Bloomberg suggests it's best to just stick to heating your food in anything but plastic. Now, quick aside, BPA-free plastic containers aren't the answer, because research suggests that BPS and BPF, the most common replacements for BPA, might have similar effects on your body. Instead, opt for replacements like ceramic or glass containers.
You have to do the best you can, and it makes sense to me to do the things that give you the most return for the least effort.
And here's the best part. Once you reduce exposure, those chemicals slowly leave your body. As Bloomberg says, they're stored in fat cells, which eventually die and ultimately leave your system.
Don't stress about it, right? Do your best and make conscious choices to improve things.
So my advice about BPA is to avoid products with BPA. They're harmful to your body, and look for the tag or the statement that says BPA free. Read the labels on all plastic containers, and that includes those plastic containers that you put your leftover foods in. So if you have a product that's probably 20 years old and it's plastic and you've been storing it, like I used to have old Tupperware that's 30, 40 years old. I did throw that away. Oh, actually, I kept part some of them because they were kind of pretty, but I used them as just containers to put coins in or things like that. But probably you should toss all those things and reevaluate how much BPA you actually have in your kitchen and other places. So let's take a look at the problems with BPA in the video, Should You Be Afraid of BPA? And I'll tell you, you should be. But let's take a look, and you can decide.
Maybe you've seen those BPA-free stickers on plastic water bottles before. Having them labeled that way makes it seem like a dangerous chemical, but you can find BPA in all sorts of things. DVDs, shatter-resistant eyeglasses, baby bottles. It's even in resin that lines some cans of food and in thermal paper receipts that you get at the store. Most people have detectable levels of it in their urine, and that hasn't caused the collapse of civilization, although 2016 may have come close. Anyway, how bad can BPA actually be? Even though there's been a fair amount of research on BPA, we still don't know if it's completely safe. BPA is short for bisphenol A, and it's one of the most common ingredients in a type of hard, clear plastic called polycarbonate. You can react it with another chemical, like carbonyl chloride, to form long chains, and those chains form a really durable plastic. Those chains are pretty chemical inactive, but the trouble comes when unreacted BPA molecules stick around in the plastic. When you heat it up, like by putting a plastic container in the microwave, those leftover molecules can become free. And that that is what might be a problem. See, BPA is what's known as an endocrine disrupting chemical. It's a molecule that interferes with how natural hormones like estrogen, androgen, and thyroid hormones work in the body. Animal studies have linked BPA to all sorts of problems, like decreased fertility, impaired fetal development, obesity, and cardiovascular diseases. But like with any health research, you can't just translate those findings to humans. For one thing, laboratory conditions don't mimic the way we interact with BPA very well, in terms of dosage or exposure. Plus, not all those research results have been reproduced. Lots of studies have found BPA is bad, but they don't always agree on how or why. Right now, the U.S. Food and Drug Administration sets the safe level for BPA exposure at half a microgram per kilogram of body weight per day. But some scientists are saying that that limit is still too high. Because BPA is a hormone disruptor, it might act differently from other toxic substances. Usually, more of the bad stuff means more bad news for your body. A tiny bit of cyanide is okay, but a lot of cyanide is not. But chemicals that target the endocrine system have been known to break that rule. According to some research, a low dose of some chemicals might be worse than a high dose, because if the body suddenly detects a high dose, it knows something's up and won't respond. So while BPA isn't definitely terrible for humans, it might not hurt if manufacturers phase it out, especially when it comes to things like baby bottles. As long as we study the new replacement plastics just as carefully. Thanks for asking, and thanks especially to all of our patrons on Patreon who keep these answers coming.
So there are some choices. You don't have to use plastic for everything. You can reduce your use of canned goods. That would be a good thing because the lining, the resin lining, has BPA. Most of them do, not everything, but most. You can choose glass or porcelain or stainless steel containers, particularly for your hot food or your liquids. And then be very selective with your plastic utensils as well as your container boxes. So it's really good to use glass and to be cautious because you know that doesn't have any BPA in it whatsoever. So today I hope that you learned a lot about nutrition during this particular session, and I wish I had more time to dive into more details on this topic and to go into some more things, but I just didn't have the time. There's just so much to learn. And next week I'm going to explain the application of some of these basic concepts in healthy eating. But for now, I want you to be aware of the nutrients and foods that you choose and make sure that you are choosing wisely. Make sure that you know what you're choosing. You've read the nutritional components on all these different products, especially on the Cheesecake Factory or other places like their Taco Bell. And just make sure that you know what you are actually eating. So here are some of my final words of advice based on this chapter. Once again, use the nutritional information that is on the internet, on all of the websites for fast food, as well as high-end restaurants also have it. Get your cholesterol levels checked. Go to your primary physician to get that done. Eat fiber every day. Drink a sufficient amount of water for your activity, your gender, and your lifestyle. And read those labels for BPA. Remember that good nutrition is an important part of living a healthy lifestyle. Combine that with physical activity every day, your diet can help you reach and maintain a healthy weight, reduce your risk of chronic diseases like heart disease and cancer, and it will promote overall health. On that final note, I will see you next time.